Welcome to Asia's IAS Institute. In this video, we are going to see June 2020 current affairs, a weekly roundup. So we are in week 2 now. Week 1 has been covered. In week 2, we are going to look at 18 to 14 June news. So all important news items from the Hindu have been picked up and we have segregated them topic wise. Here's the index, like polity, legislature, judiciary and so on. And these are the headlines plus the important keywords have been underlined. So these have been explained in detail too in the news. So let's start with it. So here we go. First news. Parliament doesn't have space to ensure physical distancing. So both houses of parliament, it has been stated, does not have space. Both do not have space to accommodate members while strictly adhering to the physical distancing norms. So since social distancing has to be maintained, so they have to be seated at a distance. So both Rajya Sabha Chairman M. Venkaiya Naidu and Lok Sabha Speaker Om Birla have stated that their Secretary Generals have told them that there is no space in the Parliament to accommodate all. So it is said that the Rajya Sabha Hall can have maximum 60 MPs while keeping enough distance between each member, and Lok Sabha Hall can have a little over 100 members. While the strength of Rajya Sabha is 250, you should know, and official strength of Lok Sabha is 552, the total strength. So you can see. So this is the problem here, you can see. And also there are other options like the Vigyan Bhavan can be used, which is used for national conferences too. So that can be also be used, the seating capacity that, but it has been ruled out. So that has much more capacity. Then also it has been stated that, only those members who can be accommodated as per social member, they should be allowed to attend. But then such, and those who are, their participation is required. But then that is not the way democracy functions. A parliament should function. And of course, opposition is going to resist any such move if any entry to members is curtailed. Then also another option is webcasting, like having online virtual meetings of parliamentary committees also. But that has also been ruled out, because it says there will be need for change of rules and that has to be approved by both houses of parliament, and parliament is not convening, so parliament committees can also not convene. Then next is Manipur Speaker to keep 7 Congress MLAs out. So this is the order coming from Manipur High Court. So why is this order coming? First of all, we have to look at a little background. So you should know about 2017 Manipur Legislative Assembly election results. So 2012 elections, you see Congress had a clear majority. In the 60 seats, it had 42, so it had formed the government. In 2017 assembly elections, Congress was the single largest party with 28 seats but did not cross the 50% mark. So it could not form the government on its own. While BJP got 21 seats, other parties 10. So actually BJP was given an opportunity to form the government and it formed a coalition government. And now BJP has been poaching Congress MLAs. So 7 Congress MLAs have defected to the BJP. This is the term, defected is the term being used by Manipur High Court itself. So if an MLA defects, actually is disqualified. And the decision whether it is a defection or not and whether it should be disqualified or not is taken by the Speaker. And it has been controversial. Speakers have to decide, and Speaker is elected by the Legislative Assembly. So the party which has the majority will be the party which will be having its say in the Speaker too. So Speaker will be from the ruling party or supporting the ruling party as such, or ruling coalition. So here the Speaker has been sitting on these petitions. The Congress member themselves have filed petitions. Congress party filed petitions in November 2018 itself regarding this defection, but Speaker has not taken a decision on them. And also a petition, a disqualification petition was filed by Manipur Congress MLA, and the Supreme Court has given its ruling. So in the courts also the case has gone, and it reached up to Supreme Court regarding one Congress MLA who had defected to BJP and had been made a minister. And the Supreme Court gave its ruling in this case and it banned his entry from the assembly as such. So later the Speaker also disqualified him, because you should remember Supreme Court cannot disqualify a member on the grounds of defection. Disqualification on ground of defection is done solely by the Speaker, by the legislative assembly, the legislative body's chair. So in this case it's the Speaker. So the Speaker disqualified him too, because eventually he was barred from entry too. So this decision was taken, but after that the ruling party and got him back as an advisor to the Chief Minister. So here you can see he was made an advisor post disqualification to the Chief Minister. So this was March 2020 order only, and now this is a case regarding other Congress MLAs too. in Manipur High Court. And Manipur High Court has directed the speaker to take a decision and restrain them from entering the house, entering the assembly. So speaker has to take a decision. He has not taken a decision since 2018. We are in 2020. Then next is, Delhi government asked to explain decline in COVID-19 testing. So the Supreme Court has asked the Delhi government why its COVID-19 testing drive has dipped from 7,000 to 5,000 a day when other equally affected cities are increasing their testing. Like Chennai, Mumbai, they have increased their testing to 16,000 and 70,000 a day. So patients and their families, it has also been seen running pillar to post to get themselves admitted. There have been videos of even COVID-19 dead being thrown into pits. So such videos have also gone viral. So the Supreme Court has taken cognizance of this and has issued notice to Delhi, Maharashtra, West Bengal, Tamil Nadu and Gujarat government to file status report on the issue on dealing with COVID-19. So the states are being questioned by the Supreme Court. The next is, Supreme Court raps government on pay cut for medical staff. So the Supreme Court has taken strong exception to the salary cuts for government and private medical staff and lack of infrastructure for them too. So it has warned the government. The Supreme Court says that the government, you do not want dissatisfied soldiers in a war. This is a war against COVID-19 pandemic. So the Supreme Court has expressed anguish over reports that doctors and healthcare staff are not being paid salaries. And there is a petition which has been filed on which the Supreme Court is hearing this matter. And this petition by a doctor has questioned the center's SOP, Standard Operating Procedure, of May 15 for frontline COVID-19 healthcare workers and it has called for 14-day mandatory quarantine for them. So that mandatory quarantine has been ended for them. So now they will not have 14-day mandatory quarantine. Also, separate accommodation facilities should be made available for doctors is being asked for, because if they go home, they expose their families to greater risks. But this is not being provided to them. So Supreme Court is now hearing this petition. And government on its part has said that Hospital Infection Control Committee, HICC, in the health facility is responsible for implementing the infection prevention and control activities and taking care of the doctors, and doctors are finally responsible to protect themselves. So this is how the government states where the responsibility lies. Atmanirbhar. Then next is, Supreme Court allows firms to negotiate with staff on lockdown. So Supreme Court has asked factory owners and other private industrial establishments to negotiate terms and enter into settlements with their workers on payment of wages during the lockdown period. So during the lockdown, whether employers are responsible to pay wages. So actually there was an order from the Home Ministry which had called it mandatory for them to pay wages. But then when the Supreme Court saw petitions filed before it, the Ministry of Home Affairs revoked that order. So now the Supreme Court says that both the employers and the employees can negotiate and enter into settlements that how they should be paid wages during the lockdown period. Because employees are also suffering. We see migrant workers suffering significantly too. Plus also employers are suffering because the businesses are down and they are entering into losses. It is said industry, the Supreme Court says, industry cannot survive without its laborers and workers. So of course we both need each other. So there are a batch of petitions which have been filed by industrial owners against the March 29 government notification. So this was a notification which has been rescinded. It has been revoked now on May 17. So after 54 days, it was revoked. So this March 29 order of the Home Ministry asked employers to pay full wages to workers during the lockdown period. But now it is no longer effective. And court continued its existing order that no coercive action should be taken against private factory or industry owners who are unable to pay wages to workers during the lockdown. This actually March 29 notification called for coercive action, but now Supreme Court has also stated that no coercive action should be taken. The next is, migrants should not be prosecuted, Supreme Court. So Supreme Court has said that migrants should not be prosecuted for trying to reach home amid the nationwide lockdown. So both center and states have been asked to withdraw complaints or prosecutions lodged against migrant laborers who had set out on foot from big cities to their native villages, because they were trying to escape starvation, unemployment and the disease during the pandemic. So all the states, union territories have been asked to withdraw the prosecution complaints which have been filed under Section 51 of the Disaster Management Act and other related offences too. So these are complaints lodged against migrant labourers for violating lockdown measures because they were moving on roads. So the bench has of the Supreme Court has asked states and union territories to also bring the stranded migrant workers home within the next 15 days if they want to. And railways also has been asked to have more Shramik special trains within the next 24 hours. It has asked for 171 more trains. The Supreme Court is ordering the railways to have more trains so that migrant workers can be transported. It also said that the states and union territories now have to look. So, it's the responsibility of the states and union territories to look at the next stage of attending to the needs of the migrant laborers too. That is their source of employment because now they have migrated to their hometowns. So, what will be the source of employment there? Their provision of food and ration, etc. has to be looked into. Also, court has asked Director Generals of Police to direct their personnel to deal with migrant workers humanely. Because there have been instances of police excesses too, while the Supreme Court said that otherwise they are doing a commendable job, but there have been instances. Also, the Supreme Court placed the onus on the center, states and union territories to provide details of employment and benefit schemes to the returned workers. Because workers may not be aware of the schemes announced by the government, so it is the responsibility of the center and states to publicize their schemes to make them known. Also, it said, for this, what can be done is counseling centers should be set up to reach out to the migrant workers. Also, extensive skill mapping of the returned workers has to be done and by the states and union territories. So, all this has been ordered by the Supreme Court. And Supreme Court took suo motu cognizance of the case. Means it has taken up the case on its own, reading media reports, not by a petition filed before it. So this is the suo motu cognizance of the migrant workers' exodus on which the Supreme Court has ruled. Government on its part has criticized high courts running parallel government with the orders on migrants. But the Supreme Court on this has said that high courts are constitutional courts. They are well within their jurisdiction to take cognizance of violation of fundamental rights of migrant workers and their proceedings shall continue. So Supreme Court says high courts will also be hearing the petitions and Supreme Court has also given its directions. Because if the courts, the high courts are the first point of reach. So, if migrant workers and or on their behalf, high courts will not hear cases, everybody cannot go to Supreme Court. So, individual cases of fundamental rights violation will of course go to high courts and high courts will give directions. The next is, don't ignore bonded labor. Supreme Court tells Bihar. So, the Supreme Court has asked the Nitish Kumar government not to turn a blind eye to the problem of bonded labor in Bihar. Merely because the administration is busy with migrant workers' exodus during the lockdown. So, it is handling migrant workers, but does not mean bonded labor issue has to be forgotten. Because it was May 11 order of the National Human Rights Commission to rescue and repatriate 118 bonded laborers working in brick kilns under inhuman conditions. So, this was National Human Rights Commission order to rescue and repatriate them to the Bihar and UP government. But there has been delay in this. From May 11, we are a month into it now. We have already reached mid of June. So, this is what we are seeing. That the order has not been implemented. And now, Supreme Court has asked the Nitish Kumar government to implement it. So, Bihar government has explained that administration was busy with the huge influx of migrant laborers. But that excuse is not accepted by the Supreme Court. So, what is this bonded labor? You should understand. So, it is an agreement entered into by the debtor with the creditor. So, why would such an agreement come into effect? Because some advance payment. Because poor people, they want some money, some advance payment is given, payshgi is given. And, the person becomes a bonded laborer to the creditor. Or it is also sometimes a social obligation that it has been running into the family and it's customary and social obligation that bonded labor is provided. It means any work which is done without any pay. So, that is called bonded labor. And third one is for some economic consideration, but these wages paid are nil or very minimal. So, that is that. And they are forfeited the freedom of employment, forfeited the right to move freely or right to appropriate or sell property. Bonded labor has actually been abolished in the country. There is Article 23 in the Constitution under the Fundamental Rights which prohibits trafficking human beings and forced labor. So, bonded labor, begar, forced labor has been abolished in the Constitution. It has been prohibited and there is already a law in place too, which is here you can see. Bonded Labor System Abolition Ordinance was promulgated and then an act was in place in 1976 and this abolishes bonded labor. But still, the problem continues. So, there you can see. center contributes 10,000 for each case of rehabilitation, while the respective states have to contribute an equal amount. So scheme has been revamped also for bonded labor in 2016, and the financial aid has been enhanced. So it's not 10,000, but now 1 lakh for adult male beneficiary and 2 lakh for children and women. Also, those rescued from begging rackets get this money to rehabilitate them. But then it is said, though the aid for rehabilitation is fully funded by the center, state governments have to submit utility release certificate to avail the funds. And there the problem arises. So release of the aid is linked to the conviction of the accused. But authorities should release 20,000 immediately to the rescued, irrespective of the status of conviction proceedings. So there are conditions also. So laborers have to be rescued, money is paid by the center. The state governments have the onus of prosecuting the accused and convicting, and also for their rehabilitation. And it is said majority of the rescued workers do not have government documents like ration card, voter card and caste certificates. So that is also being seen. And it is said that major sectors where these bonded laborers work are brick kilns, rice mills, textiles, wood cutting, charcoal units, poultry farms, snack making units, and in agriculture. So bonded labor still continues. Then next is, Supreme Court asks Jammu and Kashmir to respond to plea against Soh's detention. So this is regarding Saifuddin Soh. He was a former union minister, senior Congress leader from Jammu and Kashmir, and Supreme Court has asked the Jammu and Kashmir government to respond to a petition challenging the house arrest and or detention of senior Congress leader and former union minister for the past 10 months. So since August 5, 2019, when the special status of Jammu and Kashmir was revoked, Article 370 was abrogated, since then he has been under house arrest. And state of Jammu and Kashmir has been now reorganized into two union territories, Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh. So he has been under house arrest, and now habeas corpus petition has been filed before the Supreme Court by his wife, and it has Supreme Court has asked Jammu and Kashmir government to respond to this petition. So also it is said that the grounds for detention have not been informed so far. So obtaining a copy of the detention orders has been of no significance. There has not resulted in any response from the Jammu and Kashmir administration. And also, Mr. Soh has been denied the right to make a representation against the orders of detention. This complete abuse of constitutional guidelines and statutory scheme is what is being seen. The next is, center to take stock of Krishna and Godavari water utilization. So this comes quality interstate waters. So far what we saw was, one, we saw regarding quality legislature. And then we saw regarding the polity judiciary aspect, the court rulings, the judicial rulings, and now we come to polity interstate waters. So there's one news item under this. So Krishna and Godavari rivers, you should know, they flow through Andhra Pradesh, Telangana region. You can see Godavari is here, below lies Krishna. This is the state of Andhra Pradesh. The brown color shows the border. So Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. Telangana has been formed out of Andhra Pradesh, and Krishna and Godavari rivers, how they have to be shared, that is a concern. So Union government is going to take stock of the water utilization from Krishna and Godavari rivers. So both Telangana and Andhra Pradesh have filed complaints against each other. So there is a separate ministry also now. There is Union Ministry of Jal Shakti, which has been formed in the new government, the new Lok Sabha as such, when new Lok Sabha has been formed in 2019. So this Union Jal Shakti Ministry has asked the chairpersons of the Krishna and Godavari River Management Boards to procure the details of the irrigation projects here on these rivers, Krishna and Godavari, by Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, and also other two states involved, that is Maharashtra and Karnataka. So the projects are there of all states on these two rivers, and the requirement is to assess whether there is surplus water which will be available for new projects. So it is also true that states have started having new irrigation projects set up without even taking permission from the river boards. Like you can see Krishna and Godavari River Management Boards have been asked by the Union Jal Shakti Ministry to get the details of irrigation projects, and they themselves don't know. So the new projects have gotten into effect without getting clearance from the river boards. From the Central Water Commission, the Apex Council comprising of, which is the Apex Council actually, Central Water Commission, which has the Union Water Resource Minister as the chair and chief ministers as members. So, the Andhra Pradesh Reorganization Act of 2014 also calls for this, that permission has to be taken from the river management boards, because Krishna and Godavari rivers management boards, they include the ministers, chief ministers of the states involved. So, that is it. But they have not been informed as such, to no permission, no clearance has been taken. It is also true that of the two rivers, Krishna and Godavari, Krishna is almost dried up. And Maharashtra and Karnataka are the two states which have taken up large projects on Krishna River. So, Telangana also has projects on Krishna and Godavari River, and also Andhra Pradesh. This is a river water dispute which we see here. The next is now social health related issues. So, first one is India removes export ban on generic drug hydroxychloroquine. So, India has lifted the export ban on hydroxychloroquine, which is the anti-malarial drug touted by US President Donald Trump too as a potential game changer in the fight against COVID-19 pandemic. And manufacturers except export oriented units now and those in special economic zones will have to still supply 20% of their production to domestic market. Otherwise, there are no restrictions now on export of COVID-19. India is actually a leading exporter of generic medicines, and chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine are generic drugs and they are very cheap. Actually, India banned the export of drug of hydroxychloroquine as such in March 2020. But then restrictions were eased in the next month itself when US President Donald Trump threatened counter action, and 50 million tablets of the drugs were shipped to US in that month itself. And the generic manufacturers of these generic drugs, the two leading Indian manufacturers are Ipca Laboratories and Cadila Healthcare. So, here you can see the details as such given too. There have been some controversies with respect to this too, which we discussed last week in week 1 about hydroxychloroquine. It is an interferon blocker and it's an anti-malarial drug, but it works by diminishing the immune system's response to the viral infection. So, this virus levels quicker. So these studies have undertaken, but there have not been any trials undertaken. We also saw about the solidarity trial of World Health Organization, in which there are four line of treatments being tried, and on which research is being undertaken, and one of them is of hydroxychloroquine. But then there are instances of cardiac arrhythmia, so and liver damage because of COVID-19 or because of hydroxychloroquine in some cases. So this is a side effect. So, wide usage may actually handicap people's ability to fight the infection too, is a concern too. But then it has proved effective in the country, in India itself too, to fight in fight against COVID-19, and it has been asked to be taken as a precautionary medicine too by frontline workers, healthcare workers, as such by the government. So, generic drug, you should understand the terminology, what is it, and should not have any misconceptions regarding that. They are not inferior drugs. You can see what is a generic drug is detailed out. It's a copy of the original drug. So, it's the original drug has a patent and nobody else can have that formulation developed. So, only the manufacturer who has filed for the petition has the petition, gets to manufacture and sell under the brand name. So, they sell it under the brand name, but then patents end. So, patents, once they end, then everybody else can also have that drug manufactured. So, the copy of the original drug whose patent has ended is called a generic drug. So, it's sold under the generic name, the chemical compound name. So, that is how generic drugs are sold, and they have a cost advantage because they will cost 80 to 85% lesser than the original drug. So, because there is no research and development cost involved now. So, any drug manufacturer can make them after approval from the drug controlling authority. So, some of the leading generic drug makers also mentioned. For hydroxychloroquine, so Ipca and Cadila. But in general, generic drug manufacturers in the country are Cipla, Dr. Reddy's, Ranbaxy, such. Then there are concerns because we have a misconception that lower price means inferior quality. So it is said no, a generic drug is the same in terms of chemical compositions, dosage and safety and strength as such. So it's not an inferior drug. India is a leading exporter of generic drugs to USA too. So it's called pharmacy of the world, because we provide generic drugs to the world, even in Africa. So this is there. So given the bigger share of Indian companies, then there is greater FDA, Food and Drug Administration of Federation of Drug Administration of USA. So FDA scrutiny is more on India, because we are a leading supplier of generic drugs. So if FDA scrutiny is there and drugs are being sold in USA, it means generic drugs are approved by FDA too. Even FDA has given its statements that a generic medicine works in the same way and provides the same clinical benefit as its brand name version. So it's not inferior. The next is BSVL gets nod for trial of ulinastatin for COVID-19. So Bharat Serums and Vaccines Limited, BSVL, has received approval from DCGI, that is Drug Controller General of India, to conduct phase 3 clinical trial on ulinastatin, which is used to treat mild to moderate acute respiratory distress syndrome. And this is condition seen in COVID-19 patients too. And mortality rate increases when such syndromes are seen, pneumonia conditions develop. So acute respiratory distress syndrome is causes dry cough. Like what it causes is dry cough. The symptoms as such are dry cough, heavy breathing, breathing difficulties and increased heart rate. So ulinastatin can be administered as a remedy to combat the underlying inflammatory conditions related to ARDS in COVID-19 patients, and clinical study has been undertaken. Then next is social vaccine is the need for the hour. So we saw this in week 1-2, and now again it is the Union Health Minister now who himself has stated regarding social vaccine. The term has come up in news again. So, India is said to be in a much better position than the rest of the world in fighting COVID-19, he says, but there is no need for and no time for complacency, and he called for social vaccine. What does social vaccine means? Vaccine which has been developed is a medical vaccine, but social vaccine is society understanding, strictly adhering to physical distancing, hand hygiene, using face masks, covers, increasing awareness. So, that's the need for the hour. And social vaccine last week we had seen in context of HIV AIDS, that how there are red ribbon clubs and awareness being created about how AIDS does not spread and how AIDS spreads, so people are aware of it and they can take remedial measures once they know what symptoms are developing. So that's what is being highlighted in case of COVID-19 too, that social vaccine is required. The next is 233 evacuated from Iran under Operation Samudra Setu. So this is regarding Operation Samudra Setu, under which Indian Navy's INS Shardul has departed from Iran, Port Bandar Abbas in Iran, with 233 Indian nationals. So they have been evacuated. So this operation actually commenced on May 8, and we have already evacuated 2,874 individuals from Maldives and Sri Lanka. So now it is even Iran. So Indians from these countries have been evacuated through the sea route. We also have seen the air route being used, and this is the sea route. So, air rescue operation has been called Vande Bharat mission, and through the sea route it has been named Operation Samudra Setu. So, you should know these terminologies. Then next is, CM says Delhi hospital is only for its residents. Lieutenant General overrules. So, there are complaints coming on social media of poor treatment at Delhi's hospitals. So, in this, the Chief Minister as response had announced, Arvind Kejriwal, Chief Minister of Delhi, that all government and private hospitals in the city would only treat Delhi residents till the rising COVID-19 cases are contained. Means you have to give proof that you are a Delhi resident, then you will be allowed to be treated at government and private hospitals. And central government hospitals in the city will continue to treat patients from outside. But then Lieutenant Governor of Delhi, Anil Baijal, as in his capacity as chairperson of Delhi Disaster Management Authority, overruled Aam Aadmi Party government's decision. And he said that all patients would be treated. And Aam Aadmi Party actually accepted, the Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal readily accepted the order of the Lieutenant General and said, since the Lieutenant General says all have to be treated, so we will be treating all without any deviation. Then next is, slum population most at risk, says ICMR. So India has overtaken UK also now and has become the country with the fourth highest incidence of COVID-19 cases. And still ICMR has released its results of first sero survey on COVID-19 spread and has stated that urban slum population is most vulnerable to the spread, followed by urban settlements and then rural areas. And ICMR still says that country is not in a community transmission phase. still community transmission is being denied. Community transmission basically means that from one person to the other, it is being spread and not through direct contact. Means in the sense that somebody who came from abroad had the disease and somebody else who came in contact with them are the first line of contact who got the disease. So first line of contacts are suffering from COVID-19 is what ICMR says. Community transmission means the people who are infected, now it has spread across the community. It's not because of contact with first line of patients. So that's what ICMR still asserts, that there is no community transmission. The country is not in the community transmission phase. That has been a controversy. It is clearly seen that the number of cases, the rate at which it has been rising, of course, community transmission has taken place, but officially it is denied. The infection fatality rate is said to be very low. It is said only 0.08% are being infected. And the zero, so in percentage, of course, it will be low, but in terms of numbers, it is high. India has the fourth highest number of COVID-19 cases. So this serosurveillance study was undertaken in 83 districts. And ICMR and its other agencies were involved. So the study was done in May 2020. And this is the result you can see. That 0.73% of the population in these districts which was studied had evidence of past exposure to COVID-19. Risk in urban areas is high, you can see. And in slums, it is much higher. And fatality is low, means number of people are infected, of them how many die is 0.08%. So this covers social health related news. Next, we look at social rights. So here is the index. We'll look at it once again to understand what we have covered so far. So we covered polity legislature, polity judiciary, then polity interstate waters, social health. And now we look at social rights. There are two news items under it. The first one you can see is NHRC seeks report on deaths by police action. So National Human Rights Commission has asked for action taken reports from authorities of 7 states where 15 people died due to police action. So there have been these cases of people dying due to police action, and this has happened in the first month of the lockdown. So complaint has been filed and the National Human Rights Commission is asking for action taken report from the states. There are 7 states involved. We saw even the Supreme Court in polity judiciary. The Supreme Court, when it had given its orders on migrants, it had stated that police should treat migrants humanely. There have been instances of police excesses as such too, though overall the police has done a commendable job. So NHRC has specific complaints before it now, on which it will have hearings. So the second news item is also about NHRC actually submitting its report. You can see, government considering universal basic income, says NHRC. So this has been stated by NHRC in its report, which it has submitted to whom? To the UN Human Rights Council. So UNHRC has this universal periodic review process. So this is done every 4.5 years. So here you can see, this is the universal periodic review process. The third round of it is going on, and the National Human Rights Commission submitted this report and stated so in this report to UN Human Rights Council. So you can see the report is dated May 2020. And it has reviewed the implementation of 152 recommendations of the UPR working group that the Indian government had accepted in September 2017. So the recommendation of universal basic income has been accepted in September 2017 by the government. And now in this May 2020 review of that report, the National Human Rights Council says that the government is actively considering and is examining the universal basic income. So central government is looking into this. So this is a news which comes from this UNHRC, National Human Rights Commission report to UN. So what is this universal basic income? We have to understand that too, and how will it be implemented? So the recommendation actually was to continue studying the possibility of universal basic income as a way to further reduce poverty levels with a view to possibly phasing out the existing social protection system in full consultation with all stakeholders. So first we understand what is universal basic income, then we'll understand the statement better too. So basically, universal basic income is mentioned here. You can see what is it. Is an identical transfer to the entire population. Means it's a direct cash transfer initiative. So it is universal, means it goes to everyone. So that's the idea. So globally, actually no country has universal basic income, not for entire population, but in a limited way they have adopted it. And main arguments against universal basic income is it is unnecessary benefit to higher income groups. They don't require it. And it will be high fiscal cost to the government too. It will crowd out other spending. Because if government spends all this money here, then other spendings will be affected. And it discourages labor supply too. If people are going to get money without working as a universal pay by the government, then labor would also not be available. Though it is officially stated, but it may in an extreme case become true too, because the minimum amount which is paid will not be sufficient for people to take care of all their needs. So it depends on that too. And arguments in favor of universal basic income is that it can address poverty inequality more effectively, and it can address income uncertainty due to impact of technology on jobs too. It can help garner support for unpopular structural reforms too. So if universal basic income is provided to all, then government can implement structural reforms too. But then the cost of universal basic income is high. It is set when set at the 25% of median per capita net market income. Well, how much will it cost? 6.5% of GDP, average advanced economies, and 3.75% of GDP of emerging market economies. So this is universal basic income. You can see how it has been implemented over the years in India too. Like in 1938, a minimum income standard was discussed, but post-independence, it was in 1964 that plan to start a program for tackling poverty in the country was initiated. Pilot projects were initiated. An economic survey actually suggested this scheme in 2016-17 for bottom 75% of the population. But then if universal basic income is provided, then various subsidies would be rolled back. Like already the government has rolled back subsidies on gas, petrol, on even LPG. So subsidies will be rolled back and universal basic income would be provided. Means money would be provided in the hands of the people, then they have to take care of whatever are their basic needs, and they have to pay the market price for it. So presently government ensures like food grains etc. through PDS system are provided at very minimal costs, or subsidized food grains like 5 rupees, 1 rupee, they have been provided to the poor households. But then if universal basic income comes in place, then the money is given in the account and then they have to buy the products from market at market price. So all other subsidy schemes would be eliminated if universal basic income comes into effect. So the pros and cons are of course there with respect to this. But then what we see is leakage in the benefits being reaching out to the poor as such till the last stature of the society. So that would not happen because payment would go directly in the accounts of beneficiaries. So there'll be direct benefit transfer, so no leakages as such, ideally. So this is universal basic income across the world too. In US also, Alaska Permanent Fund distributes part of the state's oil revenues to all residents on per capita basis. So no discrimination, everybody is paid. So in some way, the Kenya had the largest experiment underway with some villages receiving $0.5 to $1 per day every day. So everybody getting the money. So Kenya has this experiment undertaken. So there have been instances. So this is universal basic income, a form of social security that involves payment to anyone without work or means of livelihood without conditions. So here it is specifically for unemployed as such. So that also is an idea which can be implemented. But then in India the number is too large, you can see. The idea actually became prominent in 2017-18 when the growth was slowing down, jobs, unemployment was increasing, and UBI can guarantee some income to everyone. So here you can see in India, if you consider the number of people in the country, it is fiscally difficult to afford such a huge amount to everyone. So number of poor in the country, you can see, are also high. So the annual cost of giving 1,500 one month to even 200 million people, to the poor people as such, will be 3.6 lakh crores. So targeted population only can be provided with this income support. So case for case against, again points are given that how it will discourage people seeking employment. And temptation to withdraw other benefits means you're giving money for all basic needs, but then the people may use it for some other purpose. Like some person in the family may be an alcoholic and spends all the money on other purposes. So that is again will result in no benefit out of the universal basic income. Then next is now the social education related issues. So these are the two news items in social education, then two news items in social rights, which we'll see. So in social education, you can see the first news is top IITs and IISCs slip in global ranking. So this is top Indian Institute of Technology, top 5, and the Indian Institute of Science all have dropped in QS World University rankings of 2021. So 2020 rankings came last year, presently what have come is 2021 rankings. So only the newer IITs, it is said, in Guwahati and Hyderabad have shown improvement, others have fallen in their ranking. The top ranked institute from India in the universal rankings is IIT Bombay. So, but its ranking has also slipped 20 places from 152 to 172 in the global list now. And some prestigious institutes like BITS Pilani, Vellore Institute of Technology have dropped out of the top 1000 list. But then there is one other private university like OP Jindal Global University. It's a new entrant in 2019. It has climbed to 650 to 700 band in the rankings. So this is the status that ranks have fallen despite government's initiative with the flagship program, which was Institutes of Eminence Scheme. So this was launched 2 years ago in a bid to boost the Indian presence in global rankings. But the results are not seen. So here you can see. Well, the justification or the clarification which has been given for falling off ranking by the HRD ministry official is that the criteria which has been used for universal ranking, it gives more weightage to perception, and the perception criteria, in this criteria Indian institutes have fallen, or actually in terms of research they have actually improved their scores. So you can see, so government also says that we have formed a committee that how can we improve the perception of the premier Indian institutes abroad. So this committee is set up as comprising of IIT directors also. So they are also part of it. So Indian institutions, it says they get zero score on ratio of international faculty and students too. So that is also there. And we also score poorly on faculty student ratio. And the justification here is also given that American universities include PhD students who are teaching or research assistants to be included in this ratio, while India counts only full-time faculty. So that ratio is poor, zero score on international faculty ratio with students, and also perception. So scoring goes low there. So this is there. You can see scoring, we have scored well on research impact, it is said, which is measured through citation per faculty. So that score is high. It is also seen that the top 7 IITs had actually decided to boycott Times Higher Education Rankings, THE. Times Higher Education Rankings earlier in 2020, questioning their methodology and transparency. So this is the 2020 rankings, you can see QS rankings. QS actually is a collaboration between THE, Times Higher Education, and QS itself. So it has begun in 2014. THE is the weekly magazine which is distributed to academics in UK and internationally too. So you can see India's top institute is IIT Bombay at 172 rank, IISc is at 185, and IIT Delhi at 193. And these are the rankings 3 years earlier. So you can see how ranking was improving from IIT Bombay. For IIT Bombay 179, it came to 162, 152, and now we have fallen 20 ranks to 172. So that is being seen. So the perception parameter was there and other parameters were there. They were there earlier too. The criteria has not changed, but the fall in ranking is evident. And this is regarding the Institute of Eminence scheme of the government too, which we spoke of. You should remember this was a scheme which the government has initiated, under which 3 institutes from public sector and 3 institutes from private sector which were picked up initially. So you can see these are the 6 institutes. BITS Pilani we saw fell out of the 1000 ranks. So Geo Institute is also there here. So these 6 institutes, 6 universities have been selected by the government for world-class university tag. So initially there were plans for having 20 institutions, but initially 6 were selected, 3 public and 3 private. So Geo Institute also marked its entry. So this is actually Reliance Industries Institute for Higher Education, and this was selected based on the plan which it put forth. It is nothing, it has not been established yet. And what this Institute of Eminence scheme will do, it will provide full autonomy to the institutions, these institutions have full flexibility in fixing their curriculum and syllabus. They can admit 30% foreign students with no restriction on fees. They'll be free from regulations also from University Grants Commission, Higher Education Council of India, All India Council for Technical Education, etc. So they will not be having regulation as such too, and they'll be provided grants by the government too. So that is for the public sector institutions. You can see selected public institutions will get 1000 crore over a period of 5 years. So originally there were 30 institutes proposed, 15 public and private, 3 were selected then. So this is the Institute of Eminence scheme. Then next is IIT Madras tops institutions in government ranking. So world ranking sees IIT Bombay at top, but government ranking at national level, that is NIRF, National Institutional Ranking Framework, sees IIT Madras as the country's best in the field of higher education. So IISc stands at the second place, IISc Bengaluru, and IIT Delhi is at the third place. So under the university category, IISc topped the list, followed by JNU, Jawaharlal Nehru University, and Benares Hindu University at third. So this ranking came a day after QS World University ranking, which showed India's best slipping in the global list. So it is said NIRF is not giving so much weightage to perception parameter. So it is giving more weightage to teaching and learning, students and faculty strength, use of financial resources, research papers, patents, graduation outcomes, etc. It is said 90% of parameters in NIRF are objective, fact-based. Only 10% is perception-based, perception by academic peers and employers. So it is more objective. But then, as we discussed earlier, the international rankings are given out every year too, and national rankings come out every year too. But the fall is happening this year. Next, we come to social rights. Next, we look at social rights, and there are two articles under this. We look at the index, you can see. So these are the two articles which we will discuss here. Next, social schemes also has two articles. So first one is last eligible declared foreigner freed from detention. So Siddiq Ali and his wife Rabia are the last two eligible declared foreigners released from any of Assam's 6 detention centers. So what is important here is that you should know there are 6 detention centers in Assam. It has been prominently in news. There are more detention centers being planned too, but presently there are 6, and they were released from the Silchar detention house, which is located in Silchar Central Jail. So there are detention centers are within the jail complexes. The other 5, Dibrugarh, Golpara, Kokrajhar, Jorhat and Tezpur, are also in the jails, respective jails. So actually in April, on April 13, 2020, Supreme Court order required conditional release of all declared foreigners who have completed 2 years in captivity. Of course, what are declared foreigners is most important. We are going to discuss what is the definition for this. But Supreme Court, this is during the time of pandemic and the first lockdown, Supreme Court ordered that all declared foreigners should be conditionally released if they have completed 2 years in captivity. So in Silchar now there are 4 declared foreigners remaining, others had completed. These 4 will complete 2 years in 2021. So who are these declared foreigners? They are persons marked up so by any of the 100 foreigners tribunals in the state of Assam. So in Assam there are 100 foreigners tribunals presently. Plans are also to increase the number of foreigners tribunals. So these are tribunals like, you know, adjudicating bodies. So they actually look into citizenship issues. So citizenship related cases come to them, and where from the state police's border wing. So Assam police border wing marks any person as illegal immigrant, and that person has to prove his citizenship, his or her citizenship, before the foreigners tribunal. And if they fail to do so, then they are marked as declared foreigners and lodged in detention centers. And the person who has been released presently, he was picked up by the border police from his residence and lodged in Silchar detention center, because the foreigners tribunals also are there. They could not, it was too late when he learned that a foreigners tribunal had in April 20 declared him as a foreigner in a one-sided verdict, means he was not even heard. So he was sent a notice which was pasted on his wall and he could not read and he didn't know about it, and he was dumped in the detention center. So there are activists, Silchar based social activist Kamal Chakravarti, who has been facilitating the couple's journey back home to be with their 2 children now. So here you can see these are the 6 detention centers. There are even children detained. So that had stopped when the case of children detained at the border in USA became internationally in news. So when that came in news, in India also steps have been taken. There are no children detained. But still there are, you can see the numbers which were given to Lok Sabha as response to a question. But these are old figures. Then this is regarding the six detention centers and how they are run by Assam's Home Department. As such, so the Central Ministry of Home Affairs has approved these detention centers. So you can see it's 4.74 crore has been spent at the detention center since 2010. There are exclusive detention center also planned. This is at Mathia in Goalpara district, which will house some 3,000 inmates and will cost 46.51 crore rupees. So they are declared foreigners, but then we don't know which country do they belong to because they don't have proof of citizenship of that country too. So where would they go? They would stay in detention centers, and that has been built for them within the country. So they can't live in the country as free individuals, but they can live in detention centers, and they are being money is being spent to build these centers for them, which is not nothing less than a jail. Then next is Vinod Dua to move Supreme Court over notice from HP Police. So journalist and anchor Vinod Dua said he was moving Supreme Court in connection with a notice issued to him by Himachal Pradesh Police. So he is in Delhi, and Himachal Pradesh Police has asked him to come and attend the police station, report at the police station, because an FIR has been lodged against him there, and this is an FIR on charges of sedition. What is sedition also is important, we will see. So what is the sedition charge? For allegedly spreading fake news through his YouTube show on communal violence in Delhi in February 2020. So sedition charges have been leveled against him by a local BJP leader, Ajay Shyam, from Himachal Pradesh. So he has been asked to come to Himachal Pradesh. So according to the complainant, Dua accused Prime Minister Narendra Modi of using deaths and terror attacks to get votes. And the BJP leader claimed that Dua had instigated violence against the government and the Prime Minister by spreading fake news. But Mr. Dua says that he is a senior citizen, and he has certain medical conditions too. He is in the red zone, and Himachal Pradesh government would require him to be quarantined for 14 days if he comes there. So it's not possible for him to come there, but he is available for any investigation through other means. So he has approached the Supreme Court on this matter. So what is sedition is important, we'll see. So this is the sedition law. It's under section 124A of Indian Penal Code, and its definition is whoever by words, either spoken or written or by signs or by any visible representation or otherwise, brings or attempts to bring into hatred or contempt or excites or attempts to excite disaffection towards the government. There's no statement or no word called violence mentioned in the definition of sedition law under the section. It says it is bringing hatred or contempt or disaffection towards the government. So that will be punishable. So this is the thing. And the punishment is imprisonment for life, to which fine may be added, or imprisonment which may be exceeding up to 3 years, and fine along with it, or even just a fine. But there have been Supreme Court rulings, landmark rulings. It was in 1962 in Kedarnath Singh versus State of Bihar, in which the Supreme Court held that a citizen has a right to say or write whatever he likes about the government or its measures by way of criticism or comment, so long as he does not incite people to violence. So this is the restriction which was brought in by Supreme Court, that anything said is fine. So the definition is very wide, but Supreme Court ruling has restricted it to incitement of violence. If there is no incitement of violence, then it is not sedition. In 1982, Supreme Court ruled that the court held that sloganeering or criticizing of parliament or just judicial setup does not amount to sedition. Just raising slogans or criticizing parliament or even the judiciary is not sedition. Then in 1995, you can see another case, you can see the Supreme Court says raising some slogans like Khalistan Zindabad a couple of times, which neither evoked any response nor any reaction from the public, cannot attract sedition charges. Such are the rulings of the Supreme Court. Then next we look at social schemes. So first one is, can coffee growers deploy MGNREGA workers? So this is regarding MGNREGA, the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. So we have seen many migrant workers have returned to their home state and in their villages, and now there is a demand for work for them. They need to be employed, and MGNREGA cannot take care of all. So there is demand for more action which needs to be done, more schemes which are required for them, and even MGNREGA can be expanded. So under MGNREGA, for coffee plantations, they are allowed to work only up to trenching activities, means digging, trenching. So in that aspect, coffee plantations are covered under MGNREGA. But professional services firm Ernst & Young LLP has suggested that coffee growers avail the services of MGNREGA workers to solve the issue of labor shortage which they are facing. So they can be used, labor from MGNREGA can be used up to yielding stage. But then sometimes skilled labor is also required for some aspects of the work in coffee plantations. But this is a suggestion being given. Since March 2020, we have seen large population of immigrant laborers have returned to their hometowns. Also, another scheme which has been talked of is Jal Jeevan Mission. So, this is the flagship program of Narendra Modi government in his second term, Jal Jeevan Mission, on providing piped drinking water to all rural households by 2024. So, it has also been pushed as a way to ameliorate some of the effects of mass migration too. There is a separate ministry which has been established, which is called the Jal Shakti Ministry. So, this is a nodal ministry for implementation of this scheme too. So, this is a new ministry which has been established in the second term of Modi government. So, what is being talked of is that the returning labor, especially those working in construction sector, skilled, unskilled or semi-skilled, may be deployed to expedite the completion of works under the Jal Shakti Mission, Jal Jeevan Mission. So, what is this Jal Jeevan Mission? You should know. So, here you can see. So, already under Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, allocations have also been increased. Already, allocation of 40,000 was increased to 60,000. And now, under Jal Jeevan Mission also, there is allocation. 11,000 crore in the budget, 12,000 as extra budgetary support, 12,000 crore. And even 50% of the amount which has been called on by 15 Finance Commission for rural local bodies. So, that is tied to grants for water bodies and sanitation. So, 60,750 crore rupees. 50% of this is tied to water sanitation, water bodies and sanitation. So that can be used as such, and work can be provided to migrant workers. So skill mapping has to be done by various state governments, and majority of interstate workers who have returned home, it is seen, are from the construction sector. So under Jal Jeevan Mission, what is the objective? Provide piped water supply to all rural households by 2024. So what they do is they integrate demand and supply side management of water at local level. So for that, steps need to be taken, like creation of local infrastructure for rainwater harvesting, groundwater recharge and management of household as such. So all this can be undertaken, infrastructure work can be undertaken under MGNREG and under by workers as such. So they can be used for Jal Jeevan Mission too, apart from MGNREG. Then comes disaster management. So under disaster management also, you have two news items. You can see one is fire, which took place at Baghjan oil field in Tinsukia, Assam, and the inflows Mumbai, which are new flood warning system for Mumbai, which has been unveiled to tackle flood related disaster. So here you can see, this is Assam Tinsukia's Baghjan oil field. So here a huge massive blowout took place in the natural gas producing well of OIL, Oil India Limited, and 13 days it has suffered this blowout. It has called in even international experts to quell this fire. OIL has said that 4.83 crore rupees has been deposited with Tinsukia District Administration to provide immediate relief to 1,610 blowout affected families. So each family would get 30,000 rupees. So this is the amount being released to. It has OIL has also suspended two officials without disclosing the reason. So this is a disaster which has struck in Assam. Then next is CM unveils iFlows Mumbai, a new flood warning system. So Chief Minister of Maharashtra Uddhav Thackeray inaugurated iFlows Mumbai, which is a state-of-the-art flood warning system, and it has been developed by in-house expertise of Ministry of Earth Science. So it has been done in coordination with BMC, the Municipal Corporation of Brihan Mumbai Municipal Corporation, that is Greater Mumbai Municipal Corporation. So it's an early warning system for flooding, and it can be especially used during high rainfall events and cyclones. So this is iFlows Mumbai, you can see the image given to it. So it will estimate the flood inundation 3 days in advance, and will give immediate weather updates too. So Mumbai has seen some of the worst floods. One in 2005 saw 944 mm of rainfall in a single day. So this is the early warning system for floods. Then next is environment biodiversity related news. So in this also, you can see there are two news items. One is regarding Asiatic lion and another regarding Indian gorilla. So first one is Gujarat now hosts 674 Asiatic lions despite canine distemper virus. So this canine distemper virus was prominently in news and this has resulted in lion deaths. But now the new latest Asiatic lion census shows increase in number of lions. So in the Gujarat census on Asiatic lions, it has been found that there are now 674 Asiatic lions in Gir Forest region. You should know this is the only region in the world where Asiatic lions exist. So here now numbers have increased, and it is also said there has been an increase of 29%. The last count was in 2015. So now they've increased 29%, and also their expanse, the area which they cover, has also increased. So at present they are in protected areas and even agro-pastoral landscapes of Saurashtra covering 9 districts over 30,000 square kilometers. So from 22,000 square kilometer area, distribution of lions has expanded to 30,000 square kilometers. But then experts say that the lion census methodology is outdated and the true mortality from the virus affecting India's lions is actually denting the credibility of Gujarat government's claims. So 2020 lion census says 674, but the canine distemper virus has already killed at least 36 lions in Gir in 2018, and this has continued. Though the government is not updating the numbers, but the experts say that canine distemper virus still continues to affect the lions. The government has also imported vaccine from USA and has even, you know, inoculated the lions with these vaccines, but still the virus has not helped, is what experts say. So there have been more deaths from the virus since Jan 2020, but no data about this has been shared, is what a biologist says. And it says Gujarat government uses 100-year-old method to count lions, and that's why it would not stand the scrutiny of contemporary science too. So no, they are the department officials, they lay stake at watering holes across the animal's territorial range, and they do not use camera trappings. So these are new methods which are used even for tiger census, like camera trappings and identifying lions based on the permanent marks on their body, the statistical estimate as such which can be made, but that is not being done. You know, like the animal's predatory patterns and prey base as such, so based on which even counting of tigers is done, but for lions it is not being used. Tigers are spread all across the country, lions they are there only in this one region, and they are not using these modern methods for census, for counting. It is said 60% of lions are outside the protected area. And this is also a major concern, because if outside the protected area, then man-animal conflict may also increase. So here you can see the Asiatic lions, the number and the area continuously increasing. And this is regarding the canine distemper virus infection too. So this is said to be one of the reasons. There are other infections also which affect the lion population, like babesiosis, protozoa infection which spread by ticks. So that is also there. So lion deaths also take place. And Gujarat government says that 300 canine distemper virus vaccines for immunizing lions has been imported, and they have been vaccinated. Even all cattle in the 100 villages in the periphery of Gir sanctuary in Gujarat have been vaccinated. And the latest figures show increase in the number of lions. And how lions population spreading is a concern, because lions have spilled outside the Gir forest, as has been reflected even the lion census of 2015 and now again in 2020. So it is said 1 in 3 lions live outside the sanctuary area. So the increasing population of lions, it is said, is forcing them to leave the protected area. Then next is, now this is also there, that a new Shetrunji wildlife division outside the Gir wildlife sanctuary is being carved out by the government to give lions a better cover too, so that they have place to live. They are moving outside the sanctuary. So. Then next is first estimation exercise of Indian gaur in Nilgiris in recent years. So this is regarding Indian gaur, the bison, which is located in the Nilgiris in Tamil Nadu, and the first population estimation in recent years has been done in Feb 2020, and it has revealed 2000 Indian gaurs inhabiting this entire division. So they live perilously close to human habitations, And majority of the girls, it is they prefer to inhabit tea estates and human settlements, and they avoid the forested area. So this is a cause of concern. It is said they do this because the food is easily available here around human settlements, and lack of threat from predators also for them. And also in forests, it has been seen reserve forests have invasive flora spreading, so their diet also gets affected. So tea estates are the good place for the Indian girls to settle in. And it is seen now that tea estates have been converted into resorts and buildings, and they are fenced, which is resulting in limiting the traditional pathway of these girls when they move between their habitats. So now Indian girls have been spotted within the towns also. So there is a steady increase in their population. It is said is misguided. That has been the case for long, that they venture into human habitations. And you can see a total of 60 girls, it is said, die each year due to accidents related to living close to human habitations. These are the two animal species, Asiatic lion and gorse, which are spoken of. Then next comes economy related news. So in economy indicators, the news is regarding World Bank estimation on economy. It has said Indian economy will contract by 3.2% in this financial year. Means India's growth will be in the negative, it will be minus 3.2%. So this is part of the Global Economic Prospects Report of World Bank for June 2020. World economy is also said to be forecasted to be contracting at 5.2%, means world economy will grow at minus 5.2%, and 60 million people would be pushed into extreme poverty. It says, the World Bank report says that emerging market and developing economies will contract by 2.5%, where India is at 3.2%. Overall developing economies growth will contract by 2.5%. So India is faring worse. And economic activity in advanced economies forecast to shrink by 7%, minus 7%. So that is the case. So domestic supply, demand, finance, trade have been disrupted due to the pandemic, and the world is seeing negative growth being estimated. So this was economy indicators related news. Then we have economy GST related news and economy sectors and telecom related news. So we see these two. So in GST here, we had the GST council meeting which took place, and in this meeting it was decided that the payment which has to be done to states, that will be done at a later time. So there is a shortfall in revenue for the states, because overall pandemic scenario has resulted in shortfall for center as well as states. And within the GST law, it has been mandated that the first 5 years of implementation of GST, center will compensate the states for any losses. But states do states also presently understand that center does not have resources and cannot compensate them. So government has put off this decision on states GST dues till July. So GST collection in the past 2 months have also reached only 45% of the target amount. So there are concerns here. So shortfall in revenues means they have to meet again. They'll meet in July and discuss the issue of compensation cess to the states. So presently no decision has been taken. The payment has been made to states for the December to February month, December 2019 to February 2020. So this payment, compensation due, has been done in June 2020 by the center. So till Feb payment has been made, but from March onwards it has not been done, and that's been decided in July. So GST collection data is usually released on a monthly basis, but no data has yet been released from April, for April or for May. So we are presently in June. So here you can see center must pay full compensation for first 5 years, means till 2022. Government has to pay compensation. Central government has to pay compensation to states. Another issue is which is there before the GST Council is regarding inversion of duty. So that we'll see what is there. In the present GST Council meeting, what was approved was measures to ease tax compliance, include reduction in late fees for past returns, and even COVID-19 related relief for small taxpayers. So, and there is a need to correct inversion of duties was also agreed upon at GST Council. But this will be done at a later time. The decision on when to do it has not been taken. That has been postponed. So this diagram here illustrates the inverted duty structure of GST, like an example given. So GST, first of all, you should understand, is a value-added tax. So before looking at this example, we look at an example of a VAT, how value-added tax works. Means taxation is on value addition. Means first is the manufacturer, then the commodity, the product goes to the distributor, then distributor gives it to the retailer, and then finally it goes in the hands of the consumer. So what happens is, at the manufacturing level, say the price is 100 rupees, but then he has to pay tax. So So VAT is to be paid. So if it is 5% VAT on this product, on whatever inputs he is giving. So on these inputs, if it is 5% VAT, then it is 5 rupees. So 105 rupees is the total amount. So 105 rupees is the rate at which manufacturer will sell to the distributor. And 5 rupees is going actually to the government. So he's paying 5 rupees to the government. So that's how it is. 5 rupees gone to the government. That's why his total spending is 105. That is what the distributor pays. So distributor has total amount now sale at 200 rupees. Means buying it at 105 rupees, he's done value addition, and total now is the commodity which he's selling for is for 200 rupees. So if he's selling it for 200 rupees, government is asking for VAT on this also. And if it is at the same rate, 5%, then it will be 5% of 200 rupees, that is 10 rupees. So his actual commodity is worth 210 rupees, means retailer will buy it at 210 rupees. And why is demanding 10 rupees from the retailer? Because he has paid 10 rupees to the government as VAT, which has come down here. And when the government gets this 10 rupees as VAT, it understands that 5 rupees it has already got from the manufacturer, which he paid here. So this 5 rupees is actually input tax credit to the distributor. So you understand this, that 5 rupees is given back. Now you would say, why the government would be bothered? Why can't it keep it all with itself? So that was what was happening. But later GST is a reform which has brought in value added tax. So earlier that was what was happening. There was double taxation and multiple taxation being done. Government was supposed to keep all the money, not to return, no idea of input tax credit. But the benefit of value added tax is that there can be no tax evasion. The entire system is in place. So actually taxation increases. Tax collection increases, because if the distributor does not reveal how much he's getting, so from the tax invoices the government can come to know when the manufacturer has sent this much to the distributor, then why distributor is hiding. So hiding and evading taxes cannot take place, and of course then consumers also have to be benefiting because less of taxation is there. So that's the whole idea of value added tax. So this is what we are continuing. So 210 goes to retailer, he wants to sell it for 500 rupees. So if he is selling it for 500 rupees, again 5% GST, 5% VAT. So 25 rupees out of 500, it will be 25. So this is the amount, 525, for which the consumer buys. But in this also you can see 25 rupees, if it is 25 rupees VAT, then out of this, 5 rupees has already been paid by first person, 10 rupees has already been paid here. So that amount, 5 and 5 has been to be deducted here. So he has to pay only the remaining amount as tax. 15 rupees as tax. So remaining actually gets 15 rupees is to be paid, means remaining 10 rupees will be input tax credit for this retailer coming from the government. Government pays back to them. So that's the idea. But now the problem arises when this 5% is not same throughout. So this 5% VAT is not the case with inputs. Inputs are at a higher percentage. They are charged at a higher percentage, and final goods are charged at a lower percentage of taxation. Then problem arises, and that is called inverted duty structure. Means inputs are taxed at 18% and supplies are taxed at 12%. So then GST credit accumulation happens. So this inverted duty structure has to be rectified. It's created when inputs attract higher tax rate than final product. So what is the impact of this? It hurts manufacturer of that product, and they have to pay higher tax on inputs. And then there is input tax credit which will be coming, which will pile up, and that results in blockage of cash flow, because money coming back from the government takes time. So their cash flow is affected. So all these are concerns. So what government wants to do, if that is the case, it wants to increase, if input, like examples are there of products where inverted duty structure is like mobile phones. Mobile phones inputs are taxed at 18% and mobile phones themselves are taxed at 12%. So final good has a lower percentage of tax than inputs. Same for fertilizers, you can see, footwear, even man-made yarn, fabric. So higher tax on inputs. So what to do for these products? The idea is increase the tax. So input and output both are at the same percentage. You can see. Tax on inputs or raw material should be less than finished goods, and accumulated unutilized input tax credit becomes cost. So government cannot refund input tax credit. It gets adjusted against tax liabilities. So it will not refund. So later tax liabilities are adjusted for. So there is a need to correct this. So committee of officers are calling for correction, and favor changes need to be done. So we'll see. Even presently GST council also said that changes need to be done. So what they propose is, here you can see, mobile phones GST is 12%, make it 18%, same as input GST on input. Fertilizer is 5% GST and inputs are at 12%, so make this 12%. So this is the GST proposed. Increase the GST on the final good also. So they become the same. So that is the idea being proposed now. But it has not been implemented yet. Then next is Pakistan copper shipments to China rose at India's cost. So this is actually in context of one copper plant, which is in Tuticorin in Tamil Nadu. Sterlite copper plant of Vedanta Group. So it is billionaire industrialist Anil Agarwal who has written to the Prime Minister on June 4, 2020 requesting him to allow the opening of this plant in overall interest of the economy. He says that India has lost 40,000 crore due to closure of this plant, of which $1.2 billion was lost in foreign exchange alone. So India is a copper exporter, but now India has become has increased imports. And Pakistan is shipping copper to China. It was done by India earlier. So China has increased copper shipment from Pakistan to China has increased 400% in the last 3 years. This is being stated by him, and he says India has become for the first time in the last 2 decades net importer rather than exporter of copper, resulting in heavy import bill too. And due to the closure of the plant, thousands of workers have also been rendered jobless. So why this Tuticorin plant has been closed? You should know the background behind it too. You can see. Also, he says that because of the closure of the plant, the precious machinery and material is idling, rusting, and there is loss of revenue because if activity takes place, then there is taxation, central and state government would also benefit. It is said the Tuticorin plant accounts for 40% of country's copper smelting capacity. So that is the impact. So why was it closed down? On environmental concerns, there were protests. We will see about the entire story behind that too. So here you can see the top sharers here in Sterlite accounts for 47.8% of total production. This is 2018 data. Hindalco 49.1% and Hindustan Copper only 3.1%. So this is the share of production of copper in the country. And now this Vedanta plant, which has been sealed, this has been sealed in 2018 on the state government order, Tamil Nadu government order. So it was in 1996 when the smelting unit of copper started in Tuticorin, and it led to protests at that time too because of pollution concerns by the plant. So people protested against it. Tamil Nadu Chief Minister Jayalalitha at that time also ordered the plant to be closed after a glass leak. National Green Tribunal also asked that there is a need to look into the complaints as such too. So National Environmental Energy Research Institute was also roped in to investigate into the matter. In 2015, the unit reopened because NIRI report was favorable, but company also sought environmental clearance to expand the plant, and this resulted in further concerns. And in 2018, when plant shut for maintenance, protests actually started because of this demand for expansion. So there was 2018 protests continued. Tamil Nadu Pollution Control Board rejected Sterlite's license for flouting pollution norms, and police opened fire on protesters in May 2018. That resulted in killing of 10 people. Further toll rose to 13 people. So 13 people died, means those injured also died. So Madras High Court then stayed the expansion of the plant too. And here you can see here that in May 28 the plant was sealed. So plant remains closed. So this is the whole incident. So now demand is being made to open up this plant so that copper can be manufactured, because it plays a major role in the country's economy, and India is importing copper now, and also Pakistan is taking over the export center, because India was exporting copper to China and now Pakistan has taken over. So earlier, in between, National Green Tribunal had allowed the Sterlite plant owners to go and look into maintenance related issues. Also, Sterlite's offer was of 100 crore rupees on corporate social responsibility in nearby villages. So that was also accepted, but the plant has not started it. Then next is Supreme Court pulls up telecom department for adjusted gross revenue order misuse. So you should be remembering this telecom sector related ruling of the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court actually accepted Department of Telecom's interpretation of revenue, that how revenue, adjusted gross revenue, should be calculated. So revenue would include everything. So here you can see AGR means all revenue, including from non-core sources accruing to telecom licenses, will be considered for computing AGR. So adjusted gross revenue means you have to pay tax. Tax has to be paid on revenue. So what is the revenue? Everything has to be taken into consideration. Means non-telecom related aspects should also be taken into consideration. So that was the ruling of the Supreme Court. So this resulted in, this was actually the demand of telecom department as such too, but telecom companies did not agree to it. And they did not pay the tax at all. Means rather than paying tax on a smaller amount, they did not pay only. So that amount kept on accumulating. And now with interest and all, it has accrued to around 1.47 lakh crore rupees from 15 telecom companies. And from non-telecom companies, it is 3 lakh crore rupees. So this is the demand now of the government from these companies. Supreme Court also ruled in favor of the Department of Telecom. So companies have to pay, but they are not in a condition to pay presently. If they pay so much amount, then they will only not be able to function. They will have to end. So that's the whole scenario presently. So earlier the ruling was, Supreme Court ruling was that this amount has to be paid in 3 months. Then the government gave some relaxation as such too. So this has taken place, but this ruling of the Supreme Court, it is on total impermissible action taken by the Department of Telecom. Supreme Court says it misused this judgment to demand 4 lakh crore in adjusted gross revenue from public sector undertakings. So telecom companies, there are PSUs also which are telecom companies. So from public sector telecom companies also demand was made to pay this amount because Supreme Court ruling demands. But Supreme Court said there was no mention of public undertakings to pay this adjusted gross revenue. Because you understand, public sector undertakings are funded by the government. They are attached to the government. So if public sector undertakings also pay revenue to the government and they are not making so much of profits, so the money is going in the hands of the government. So that is questionable, because why public sector undertakings should be taxed. So that's the case. It's like you are renting out a place. So those whom you are renting out, like this, in this case, it may be the spectrum. So you are renting out something to the outsiders, you are taking rent from them, but for your own child also you will not take a rent, right? But then that is happening. So that's what the Supreme Court became furious on, that how can Supreme Court's name be used and the judgment be misused to ask public sector undertakings to pay adjusted gross revenue so that they will not be able to function. So this is the whole thing. Also, government said that the telecom companies can pay this amount over 20 years, the 20-year formula. So this 1.42 lakh crores will be paid in 20 years. So Supreme Court has raised concerns over that too, because 20 years is too long a period. If the company goes into liquidation, what will happen? Then how will the government secure the dues? So such questions have been asked. Solicitor General Tushar Mehta, appearing for the government, said that the formula was chalked out considering the impact of such huge payouts on private telecom sector. So bench actually threatened contempt action against officials also. Because one is the variation in the ruling of the Supreme Court, which has been done for private PSUs, and demand being made from public private telecom companies, and demand being made from public companies. This has resulted in bench threatening to initiate contempt action against the officials responsible for such demand from PSUs. So that is that. So Supreme Court actually had given only 3 months time. Government is giving 20 years time. Actually, Tushar Mehta, the Solicitor General, also said that the court should add a line clarifying that the judgment does not include PSUs, but Supreme Court refused to do that and directed the government to file an affidavit within a week explaining this demand made on PSUs using Supreme Court verdict as a basis. So how can PSUs be asked to pay such taxes? So here you can see. Then next is banking related news. So first one is RBI moves comprehensive norms for sale of loans. So RBI has proposed a comprehensive set of norms for sale of loans by banks, which could either be standard or substandard. So loans are given by banks, but then these loans can also be securitized. So what is the idea is to build a robust secondary market for bank loans that could ensure proper price discovery and can be used for as an indicator for impending stress also. At how the loans are faring at the market level. So at present, you can see there are rulings on this. There are RBI orders, but they are across various circulars. So what RBI is seeking to do is having a comprehensive set of norms. So loan sales actually are carried out by lenders, means by the banks or any entity which has the lending. So for reasons ranging from strategic sales to rebalancing the exposures, to or even as a means to achieve resolution of stressed assets by extinguishing the exposures, etc. So lenders have loans. So this loan sales take place means lenders are saying that this is a loan which we have and this repayment is going to come. So you can buy this loan from us. That is loan sales. So strategic sale can take place, and even if it is a stressed asset, resolution of it is done through loan sales. So that is called securitization of loans. So this takes place through commercial banks. Lender can be a commercial bank or any financial institution, even an NBFC, a small finance bank, etc. So Supreme Court is going to come up with comprehensive set of loan norms for sale of loans. So standard assets would be allowed to be sold by lenders through various means like assignment, novation, etc. But stressed assets will be only through assignment or novation. So this has been announced by RBI. Also, RBI has proposed to do away with the requirement for minimum retention requirement for sale of loans. Means there is a minimum retention requirement that when the lender, bank or NBFC selling a loan will have a minimum retention. So this minimum retention requirement can also be done away with, is what RBI has proposed now. Even the revision in guidelines is attempting to align the regulatory framework with Basel guidelines, the international guidelines on securitization, which has to come into effect from, which had to come into effect from 1st Jan 2018. So what is the securitization as shown here in a diagrammatic form too? We see this. You can see. So securitization refers to the process of pooling and selling existing assets in the book of a lender or a creditor to a special purpose vehicle and repackaging them into tradable asset-based securities. This is again, these all these assets means all those loans are put into a special purpose vehicle, and then that loan is securitized and in the capital market they are traded. Then next is, banks still await RBI guidelines on 20,000 crore equity support scheme for micro, small and medium enterprises. So 1 month after Union Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman announced the revival package for stressed MSMEs, micro, small and medium enterprises, the scheme which was announced, 20,000 crore equity support scheme, has yet to be implemented. It has also been approved by Union Cabinet on 1st June. And the scheme calls for is for MSMEs. As such, you can see, banks are expected to provide them subordinate debt. As such, up to 15% of the existing stake. So this debt can be provided, means a maximum debt which can be provided is up to 75 lakh rupees. So this is 20,000 crore equity support scheme. So there are 2 lakh stressed enterprises in the country and they may benefit from this. But then the issue is that RBI is yet to issue guidelines for this, because RBI approval is required for relaxing the higher provision requirement. So if these are stressed entities, so there is provisioning which needs to be done. So if a bank has given loan to them and they are stressed entities, means they have not been able to pay. So if this is a stressed MSME, then bank will have to make more provisioning for them. So this higher provisioning requirement is there. So if the bank is now further providing them any equity support, so there will be higher provision requirement which has to be relaxed. So RBI has allowed banks to recast debt of micro, small and medium enterprises which are still standard, but then with respect to these stressed MSMEs, now RBI's provision is weighted. So RBI has to relax these higher provisioning requirements. Then only banks will be assisting the MSMEs. And this scheme was there till March 31, 2020 from 1st Jan. This was for standard accounts, means not stressed accounts. But now it has been extended till 31st December. So this is a subordinate debt for stressed MSMEs. 2 lakh MSMEs likely to benefit, because these MSMEs, stressed MSMEs or with non-performing assets, were ineligible. Now they become eligible for support. So the amount which has been provided to them will be supported by and guaranteed by CGTMS, that is Credit Guarantee Fund Trust for Micro and Small Enterprises. So this will provide partial credit guarantee support to banks up to 65%. So they will be given debt by banks, which they then can infuse in their unit and give a boost to the economy. So that's the idea of 20 lakh crore equity support to MSMEs, micro, small and medium enterprises. Then comes bilateral relations. So topics under the bilateral relation, you can see we have bilateral and international relations left now. So there are three topics, this with respect to China and Nepal. Then international relations is regarding the anti-racism marches, and international organization is related to ICC targeting by Trump with respect to Afghan war crimes. So we'll see this quickly now and finish off. So first one with respect to bilateral relation is China reaches accord with India on LAC split. So this is regarding the line of actual control. So India has now reached an agreement with China on the ongoing tensions. And India has announced that troops from both sides have begun partial disengagement from the standoff points. So there were standoff points, five standoff points, but Chinese troops still are present at Pangong Lake. So India was firm on restoring the status quo of April and pulling back the Chinese troops and equipments. And Chinese side has also moved back. Actually, the entire thing initiated because of Chinese side raising objections to India's infrastructure development along the border. And India had also raised concern because China's Chinese side has already developed infrastructure. So it would go on Indian territory side. China has already developed. Why can't India develop on its sides? So that was the concern. But now the agreement has come forth. But still, Pangong Lake standoff continues, it seems. There the troops have not withdrawn. Chinese troops have not withdrawn. Also, you should know that 2020 is the 70th anniversary, 70th year of establishment of diplomatic relations between India and China. That is also highlighted in the context of which an early resolution has taken place of the conflict. So here you can see the entire timeline. The standoff, it started from May 5 and has finally ended with talks and resolution of the dispute. So though the boundary has not resolved, but at least the troops are moving back. Then next is man killed in border firing by Nepal police. So 25-year-old man was killed and two others were injured in firing in Sitamarhi district of Bihar, where Nepal police allegedly opened fire on the border. So it is said that we should know first of all that Nepal has changed its map and it has shown some parts of India as belonging to Nepal. And here also the victim's father says that his son was working on the field. And Nepal actually has shown that this belongs to them as such. So the incident took place between locals actually and the armed police of Nepal. So it is said the Sashastra Seema Bal SSB, which is involved in India-Nepal border related issues, it was not involved. So here you can see Nepal actually shares 1850 kilometer open border with India. So people travel across for work and make family visits. So it is an open border. We do not require any visa as such to travel to Nepal as such too. But now Nepal has closed its international borders since March 22 in the COVID-19 pandemic related issue. And erected a new border check security post on its westernmost district near Kalapani in Uttarakhand. So Defence Minister actually had inaugurated a few days earlier on 8th May this new road. Darchula Lipulekh Link Road was inaugurated. So this runs in a disputed region, and Nepal, that's why, erected new border security post. It has approved a new map as such too. It has amended its constitution too. So this is the region you can see. This is India-Nepal border. Here lies Uttarakhand, and here you can see this is Kalapani Lipulekh Pass. So this is Lake Mansarovar in Tibet in China. So what India is building is this road. So this is the motorable road here. This route is under repair. And this is a track. So this Darchula Road, you can see Darchula Lipulekh Road, which was being constructed, which has been inaugurated now. So this was a trekking route. So this has been inaugurated, and this region is disputed area between India and Nepal. And here you can see Nepal has also passed the second constitutional amendment bill on the new map. So Nepal's parliament, which is called Pratinidhi Sabha, has unanimously voted for the second constitutional amendment bill. So it guarantees legal status to the new political map which Nepal has unveiled, which shows parts of Indian territory in Uttarakhand as belonging to Nepal. So this bill was passed unanimously, means nobody voted against the bill. So 11 members remained absent or abstained. So Nepal claims that the land on the east of River Kali, which forms the country's western border, belongs to it. But then the dispute is on the origin of the river. So Nepal says origin of the river is much higher in the Himalayas, And India opposes this notion, says origin of the river is much further down. So Nepal's territorial demand is not as what it says. So this is that. The whole thing is initiated after Defense Minister Rajnath Singh actually inaugurated the road, Darchula-Lipu-Lekh Link Road. So this road was inaugurated on May 8 and on May 20, Nepal unveiled the new map. So Nepal said that we strongly protest, Nepal had earlier strongly protested because Indian map was also published in November 2019 showing the region as part of Uttarakhand. So Nepal says that we have allowed India to station troops there in 1950s, and Delhi has refused to remove the forces from the region ever since. So this is now the dispute between India and Nepal too on this region. You can see Limpiadhura Lipulekh Kalapani region. So, and this is the Kali River, the blue line. So India says the origin of the river is much below, so this area does not belong to Nepal. Then international news, first one is, so demonstrations were planned across United States to demand racial justice after George Floyd's death in Minneapolis police station custody. So weekend rallies have been spreading to smaller communities too now, even in East Texas town, which was once heaven for Ku Klux Klan. What is this Ku Klux Klan, you should know? This is actually white supremacist organization of United States. It was formed in 1866. And it's a secret society opposed to American African obtaining civil rights, particularly the right to vote. So, you know, slavery was finally abolished in America. So, KKK used violence and intimidation to frighten blacks. And Klan members, they wore white robes and hoods to hide their identity too. And they have known to have murdered many people too. So, this is the Ku Klux Klan. So, even in these heaven regions where in Texas town where Ku Klux Klan was once prominently functioning, here also it is now being seen that anti-racism protests are taking place. Also in Australia, in European cities like London, Paris also, this protest took place with the message Black Lives Matter. And also protests took place in Palestine too with hashtag Palestinian Lives Matter after a Palestinian autistic boy was mistakenly considered a terrorist and shot by an official, Israeli official. Israeli Prime Minister also said that this was unjustified and a tragedy and offered condolences to the bereaved family. And here also you have another news with respect to Australia. So this is Australia, regarding Australia-China relations, and this has COVID-19 in background too, because Australia has actually demanded that there is a need to look into the origins of the deadly COVID-19 pandemic, the demand which has been made by USA too. So China reacted furiously to this, and China is actually Australia's largest trading partner too, a major source of lucrative international students and tourists also. And after such statement coming forth, China has actually imposed tariffs on Australian barley and issued travel warnings to tourists and students over virus-linked racism against ethnic Asians in Australia. But the present news is regarding this Australian national who has been sentenced to death in China for drug trafficking. He was actually arrested in 2013. He was found with more than 7.5 kg of methamphetamine in his checked luggage. So they have given capital punishment. Australia says that the country is opposed to capital punishment. They have also provided consular assistance to the Australian national, but his identity has not been revealed, citing privacy obligations. But this is another development in Australia-China relations. Next is New Zealand is free of COVID-19. Nation lifts restrictions after 75 days. So New Zealand has lifted all social and economic restrictions except border controls after 75 days. So, on 8th June 2020, it declared it was free of COVID-19, one of the first countries in the world to return to pre-pandemic normalcy. And New Zealand Prime Minister, Ms. Jacinda Ardern, who is 39, has won global praise for her leadership during the pandemic. And the last news is, international organization, this is Trump targets ICC with sanctions over Afghan war crime case. So, ICC is International Criminal Court, and it is investigating into whether US forces committed war crimes in Afghanistan. And on this, President Donald Trump has issued an executive order authorizing sanctions against individuals involved in ICC probe. White House officials say that this is actually Russia which is making the organization look into this matter. And US Secretary of State Mike Pompeo is allowed to even block assets in the US of ICC employees involved in the probe. So they are accusing Russia of initiating this. And it also authorizes the secretary to block entry into the US of ICC employees involved in the investigation. So ICC actually has jurisdiction only if member state is unable or unwilling to prosecute atrocities itself. ICC was established in 2002 and USA has not been a member of this. Only Afghanistan is a member, and Afghanistan itself also is a puppet government of USA. It's supported by USA. So it also says that ICC should not investigate. Prosecutors looked into this matter, and after preliminary examination in 2017 said ICC has a role and it will look into war crimes. And here you can see, you should know the difference between ICC and ICJ. International Court of Justice is the official court of UN, established in 1946. But ICC is established in 2002. It is independent, but it may receive cases as referral from UN Security Council too. Both are headquartered in The Hague, and here types of cases are with ICJ are contentions between parties or advisory opinion, while International Criminal Court looks into criminal prosecutions. So that's the major difference. So that is it. We stop with this. Thank you.